Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 5th General K.S. Temaya Memorial Lecture. Let's please take a moment to ensure that our cell phones are on silent, and may we please stand for the school song. Thank you. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, we are privileged to have with us today Mr. G.K. Pillai, Mrs. Sudha Pillai, Malvika and Sudhir Kamath, General and Mrs. Chengappa, General and Mrs. Chengappa, K.C. Bellyappa and Nicole, Colonel Baba, Mrs. Baba Karyappa, other members of the family of General Temaya, Admiral and Mrs. Shekhawat, General and Mrs. Jaitley, Admiral Dawson, Air Chief Marshal Fali Major, Colonel Ellis, and the list goes on. Mrs. Sagari Mutana, Mr. and Mrs. Watsa, very eminent friends, veterans and serving officers of the armed forces, eminent members of the Indian Administrative Service, the Police Service, and other walks of public life, former principals, teaching staff of the Boys and Girls Schools, friends and well-wishers of the lecture series, and importantly, Cottonians past and present. We are truly privileged to come together to celebrate the life of General K.S. Temaya, a man, an ideology, a legend within and beyond the nation. We saw on the screen earlier the postage stamp issued by the Cyprus government in recognition of his exemplary service to the cause of peaceful resolution of the disputes between the Greek and Turkish Cypriots as the chief of the UN peacekeeping force. K.C. Bellyappa, the general's grandson, reminded me last night that General Temaya doesn't belong just to the family or to Bishop Cotton. He's a universal figure. We know that he was awarded a Distinguished Service Order by the British government for prolific leadership, resulting in the Japanese surrender in World War II. We know of his stellar role as the commander of the forces involved in the peaceful repatriation of prisoners from North Korea. Equally, we know of his magical deployment of Stuart light tanks in Zojila, or for that matter, his statesmanlike advice to the Union government on matters relating to China, or in fact, his zero tolerance of any act that lowered the morale of his troops, even if that meant taking on the Prime Minister or the Defence Minister of the time. We perhaps do not know that Lord Mountbatten had himself strongly recommended to Prime Minister Nehru that General Temaya be appointed India's first Chief of Defence Staff. And I thank Colonel Karyappa for making available that letter, and so also the Cyprus stamp. We also perhaps do not know that when General Temaya visited Bishop Cotton, he waited at the door of the then warden without imposing himself on anyone, notwithstanding the fact that he was the commander-in-chief of the Indian Army, or that he in fact bashed up an English boy for making a racist remark against him while in school. Ladies and gentlemen, General Temaya was, to use a phrase that certain suiting companies use very casually, a complete man. We are blessed to be able to celebrate his life and to so intimately share in his legacy. He, along with Dr. Raja Ramanna, have set a standard for the alumni of Bishop Cotton, and I dare say that our speaker today, Mr. Gopal Pillai, as well, that has become our guiding force. We are uplifted to be able to hold these lectures in the memory of General Temaya, and more so, to be able to hold these lectures in his beloved school, Bishop Cotton. It is equally uplifting for all of us that Bishop Cotton has at its helm today Colonel Ellis, a soldier, an educationalist, and personally, I must confess, a source of great inspiration and support to all our endeavors. It gives me great pleasure, Colonel Ellis, It gives me great pleasure to request Colonel Ellis to please render the welcome address. Colonel Ellis.
Good morning, friends and well-wishers of Cotton, former principals, members of the staff, principals, staff and students of the Bishop Cotton Girls' School, and my dear, revered, distinguished old Cottonians. I stand here representing the present students and the staff community to welcome you, each one of you, into this school, into this auditorium, and most importantly, into our hearts. We are here for the 5th annual General Thimaiya Memorial Lecture, organized every year by a few very committed Cottonians, the tribute being to an exemplary Cottonian and an outstanding human being, and most important to Cottons. We as teachers often question ourselves as to what or as to by what means can man's contribution in the world be best remembered. Various answers come to our minds. Perhaps it could be done by the erection of material and physical monuments, or perhaps some of the works are in themselves lasting monuments. But when, as teachers, we look into it, we find there's a bigger answer, that man's contribution, which lives to influence the life and progress of posterity, are the most permanent monuments that can be ever erected. To this yearly annual retreat lecture is a tribute to that, and each year a large number of us come together and add a new layer to this beautiful monument that started 5 years back. And through this monument, leave lasting impressions on the minds of these young wards of ours. Impressions which in time to come would give them and inspire them to take their place of leadership in the society they inherit, as most of our distinguished guests today have done, and others are continuing to do so. So we are here gathered as a community of hope, and I can assure you that this effort of ours of coming together for these children will not go in vain. For I'm sure that it will ignite a number of these minds to come out and make it a better world. So welcome, friends. Welcome each one of you for your contribution today by being present here. And as a symbol of our appreciation, I would request the students to present a bouquet of flowers to each one of those who lead us. May I request the school captain to welcome our chief speaker today, Mr. G.K. Pillay, the Union Home Secretary and our OC of repute. The head of day scholars, may I request you to welcome Mrs. G.K. Pillay. I request the students to welcome Major General and Mrs. K.M. Chengappa, General Thimaiya's son-in-law and daughters. May I request them to welcome Admiral and Mrs. V.S. Shekhawat, patron, General Thimaiya Memorial Trust. May I request the students to welcome Lieutenant General and Mrs. S.K. Jetley, patron, General K.S. Thimaiya Memorial Trust. The patron of the OCA is not here, but we welcome Mrs. M.G. Muthanna. We welcome you, ma'am. We also welcome Mr. Mike and Mrs. Watsa, OCA Chairman. I would also like to welcome Mr. and Mrs. A.T. Balraj, our former principal. And Mrs. Balraj. I would also like to welcome Dr. Francis Samuel. Mrs. Samuel cannot be here with us. She's unwell. Welcome, sir. I would also welcome Mrs. Franklin, the principal of the girls' school, for having always supported us. And also welcome the two great spirit behind this lecture, Mr. Aditya Sondhi and Mr. C.N. Kumar. May I request you to welcome Mr. and Mrs. Aditya Sondhi. Mr. Aditya Sondhi. Mrs. Sondhi. Thank you, ma'am, for being the spirit behind Aditya. Thank you, friends.
Thank you, Colonel Ellis, for that warm, floral welcome, which I don't think some of us deserve. We felt for a while as old boys that probably we were, with the passage of time, getting a little isolated and alienated from Cottons, but I can now, I suppose I speak for all of us, I can now say that the umbilical cord is well and truly in place. Thank you, Colonel. We owe it to you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, General Thimaiya brought grace to every institution that he was associated with, not just Bishop Cotton. Be it the Prince of Wales, RIMC Dehradun, Sandhurst, the Kumau Regiment, the Indian Army, the United Nations, or even for that matter, the United Planters Association of South India. It is a matter of singular honor for us that we have the moral support of the Kumau Regiment in conducting this lecture this year. We were meant to have with us today the Colonel of the Kumau Regiment, Lieutenant General Avdesh Prakash, the present military secretary. Unfortunately, General Prakash's brother fell critically ill and he had to cancel his visit literally at the last minute. The military secretary has personally requested me to convey his sincere regrets at not being here today as much as he would have desired to, and also to convey his warm wishes to all present, particularly Mr. and Mrs. Pillay, the family of General Thimaiya, and all officers of the armed forces. The military secretary also sent to me a copy of his speech and asked me in very stern military terms to treat it as appropriate. So I thought it would be most appropriate, particularly having read this very, very thoughtful and well-crafted speech, to take the liberty of reading this speech to you, and I hope you will bear with me as I do that. This is the introductory address of Lieutenant General Avdesh Prakash, PVSM, AVSM, VSM, and I quote, "It is indeed a matter of immense pride and privilege for me today to be standing in front of this august gathering, which amongst others also has Mr. Gopal Krishna Pillai, the Home Secretary, present amongst us. As the Colonel of the illustrious Kumau and Naga regiments, it is indeed a rare honor to have been invited to introduce the General Thimaiya Memorial Lecture, instituted in the memory of an officer who is a legend, not only within the regiment, but also in the Indian Army. I must therefore thank the General Thimaiya Trust and its patrons to afford me the opportunity not only to speak to all of you, but also to experience firsthand the hallowed portals of the Bishop Cotton School, General Thimaiya's alma mater. It would be difficult for me to chronicle the exploits of General Thimaiya in the short time that I have today, but I would definitely like to dwell on the character of a man who was the very epitome of an officer and a gentleman. General Thimaiya, as we all know, hailed from an affluent family and was sent out in an early age to a boarding school to acquire quality education considered so essential during the times. Bishop Cotton School was a significant milestone that the General touched along this journey. Interestingly, his arrival at the school, accompanied by his brother, was by itself very eventful. Addressed derogatorily by a group of students, he retaliated in a manner that he considered appropriate with his fists. On being admonished for landing the first blow and held responsible for initiating the fight, Thimaiya chose to leave immediately and not join the school at all. This primarily because he was convinced that the course of action he had adopted was correct and one which he proceeded to defend zealously. However, the principal's adroit and cheerful handling of the episode left a lasting impression on the young man's mind and eventually paved the way for the boys to be admitted to the school. The school provided him the wherewithal to express himself in multifarious fields, especially as a sportsman, and also notably as a singer in the school choir. Very significant progress, though, was made in the way Thimaiya began to see the British. In his earlier school, he had seen them as a master race, haughty disciplinarians who lacked sensitivity. Here, he observed a new side to them, warm, wiser, and gifted. He began to admire them, their ways, and also the manner in which they conducted their social lives. These were experiences that were to pave the way for the young man to consider a career as an army man, although the final decision to do so was taken in consultation with his father and led to Thimaiya joining the Prince of Wales, RIMC, a necessary stepping stone towards the Indian Army in those days. Thimaiya's military career began at Sandhurst, for which he was one of the only six Indian cadets nominated after a stringent selection process, which culminated with an interview by none less than the Viceroy of India himself. Needless to say, he gave a fitting account of himself despite the somewhat biased conditions that prevailed in the academy for Indian cadets. On commissioning in 1926, he spent his initial year in the 2nd Battalion of the Highland Infantry, a pure British troops unit. Later, he was assigned 419 Hyderabad Regiment, which became his parent unit for the rest of his military career. It was also the beginning of a glittering career that saw him handling various appointments of repute on his way to reaching the pinnacle, that is, the Chief of the Army Staff. Before I wax eloquent on General Thimaiya's contribution to the Army, I must speak of his association with the Kumau Regiment, which is today the largest and amongst the most decorated in the Indian Army. It also has the unique distinction of being the only regiment which has had three of its doyens rising to be chiefs of army staff. General Thimaiya, as I mentioned earlier, was commissioned into the 419 Hyderabad Regiment, which was amongst the battalions that later formed the Kumau Regiment of today and is presently called 4 Kumau. The 419 was peculiar in its class composition in that it drew troops from the Kumau Hills as also Ahirs from the areas of South Delhi. Compared to other battalions which were pure in their composition, such a mix was considered a man-management challenge, but Timmy, as he was popularly called, brought this inherent communication skill to the fore and made certain that the Hyderabads did not suffer in comparison to their illustrious peers in any activity, operational, administrative, or extracurricular. Thimaiya commanded the 819 Hyderabad Regiment in Burma during the Second World War, and here too he achieved perfect synchronization amongst the Kumaunis and the Ahirs, excuse me, to achieve outstanding success where supposedly more superior British units had indeed failed. A very interesting episode highlights the canny ability that Timmy possessed of alleviating the troubles of his men. The Ahirs in his unit depended on milk as a primary source of their nutrition, but were almost getting none in Burma. The deficiency was beginning to affect their health. Timmy hit upon an ingenuous idea of offering them nutritious soup made from pork and beef kidneys. It was, of course, blasphemous to expect the Muslim Ahirs, or for that matter, the Hindus, to drink it. But Timmy drank the soup in front of a subedar and remarked how lip-smacking it was. Further, before the officer could even question him about the contents, he proceeded to give him a sermon on the heating mechanism of the tin that carried the soup. The nonplussed subedar drank the soup, endorsed it as delicious, and soon the entire lot of troops was drinking it in loadfuls. His conscience did not bother him in the slightest in making the men do something that may have been considered morally reprehensible. The men were innocent, they suffered nothing spiritually, and physically they showed visible improvement, which was in any case the aim of the whole exercise. The 819 Hyderabads especially distinguished themselves under his leadership in the now famous Battle of Congaur. Timaya's innate talents of professional soldiering and leadership were soon recognized by Field Marshal Sir Claude Auchinleck, the Commander-in-Chief of the Indian Army, and he was specially selected to lead the 268 Infantry Brigade as part of the British Commonwealth Occupation Force in Japan. He proved to be an outstanding commander, and his diplomatic skills emerged wonderfully in his dealings with General Douglas MacArthur, the Supreme Allied Commander of the South Pacific Theater, and other allies of the vanquished Japanese. He represented the country during the surrender of the Japanese in Singapore, followed by the one in Philippines. Timaya returned to India in 1947 and was a member of the committee to agree to the allotment of weapons, equipment, and regiments that were to remain in India after partition. Later, as GOC of 19th Infantry Division, he gave a glowing account of his generalship when he first halted the raiders, in the Kashmir Valley and then drove them beyond Uri. The master stroke, however, was to employ tanks of the 7 Light Cavalry at the dizzying, snow-laden heights of Zojila Pass, thereby striking terror into the hearts of the raiders who had entrenched themselves on dominating heights. Timmy yet again had thought beyond the ordinary and won the day for his country. His plan was to drive the raiders all the way back to Muzaffarabad, but his pleas for just 3 months to do this fell on deaf ears, and the rest, as they say, is history. General Timaya took over as the Chief of Army Staff in May 1957 and continued till May 1961, completing a glittering career spanning 35 years. His standing up to Mr. V.K. Krishna Menon, the then Defense Minister in 1959, in protest to what he considered interference in purely military matters, was symptomatic of his forthright personality. Timmy then went to head the United Nations mission in Cyprus, and here his earlier experience as the commander of the UN Repatriation Commission in Korea stood him in good stead. Needless to say, he excelled, and after his death in July 1964, while still in Cyprus, he was accorded the rare privilege of a road being named after him in Larnaca, Cyprus, and also here in Bangalore. At the end, I must salute one of the finest soldiers and officers to have donned uniform, and I feel extremely proud to be part of the regiment that the great general served in all over the world. I also assure all who sit here today, and many others who matter and have not been able to make the journey, that the Kumao and Naga Regiment is carrying on the worthy legacy of General Timaya and will continue to do him proud in times to follow. Jai Hind. I unquote. Ladies and gentlemen, I think from the text of that marvelous speech, you can tell how sincerely Admiral Prakash wanted to be with us today. We, on behalf of the Trust, convey our support and concern, and we hope his brother makes a speedy recovery. I must personally mention the warmth and enthusiasm with which General Avdesh Prakash met me at the South Block when I met him a few months ago, and the sort of delight and enthusiasm that he showed for this lecture series was really stirring. Copies of the regimental coffee table book, the regimental ties, General Sri Nagesh's autobiography, and other memorabilia is available for display and sale at the entrance of the auditorium. I'm sure all of you would like to pick some of these unique items up for posterity. All sales of the memorabilia would go directly to the regiment. I must here also place on record our acknowledgement and gratitude for our patron, General Jaitley, whose kind efforts facilitated our connecting with General Prakash and with the Kumaon Regiment. Thank you, General Jaitley. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a scintillating topic today: India's internal security challenges and responses, a topic that is laden with debate and complexity. Some of the questions that trouble us as ordinary citizens are: is Naxalism the single biggest threat to India's internal security? And if so, how far does the Red Corridor extend? Is the response of the Union of India based on force or negotiation or both? What, if any, are the foreign elements and political elements involved in supporting Naxalism? Is there any longer a difference between Naxalism and terrorism, or for that matter, between internal security and external security? To what extent, if any, are the Indian armed forces to be involved in matters of internal security? Does law and order, being a state subject, prejudice the efforts of the center? Is there need for legal reform and police reform? Is the collaboration of various security and intelligence agencies involved in matters of internal security becoming a serious concern? Are human rights activists and the media a boon or a bane? So on and so forth. We could not have had, and I sincerely mean this, a better speaker to address some of these issues, and I'm sure a great deal more, other than Mr. G.K. Pillai, the Union Home Secretary. And more significantly, not only to address the challenges that face us, but also present to us the responses of the Union Government. You will agree with me that the timing of this lecture is all the more relevant today. A 1972 batch Kerala Cadre officer, Mr. Pillai has had a sparkling career in the Indian Administrative Service, having previously served as the Commerce Secretary, the Director General of Foreign Trade, the Chairman of the Board of Approval for SEZs and EOUs, India's Chief Negotiator at the WTO. Concurrently holding post of Secretary, Department of Justice, Ministry of Law and Justice, Mr. Pillai, as the Union Home Secretary, is at the helm of Home Affairs at a time when internal security is a matter of grave and current concern. Having resolved complex disputes with the Bodos, and more recently with respect to the volatile Gorkha Hill Council, and having earlier served as the Joint Secretary for Northeast India in the Home Ministry from 96 to 2001, as well as in the Defence Ministry, Mr. Pillai is an asset to the Union Government in dealing with the prevailing challenges of internal security. We're sure, Mr. Pillai, that we'll get a candid and a holistic address from you. We're privileged to have you, sir, with us. I must tell you, ladies and gentlemen, that Mr. Pillai, interestingly, also holds an MSc from IIT Madras, besides a BSc from St. Joseph's College of Arts and Science, Bangalore. Of course, he passed out from Cotton's Inc., in case any of my friends from Joseph's were getting excited. He passed out in 1964, and he was in Pope House. This, ladies and gentlemen, is... This is a hat trick of sorts, our third successive speaker from Pope House. I'm sure none of us have forgotten Colonel Lalit Rai or Philip Wallen, and Phil is with us today. We haven't forgotten those marvelous, marvelous keynote addresses that we received the last 2 years. In my time, and perhaps in most times, we used to say popes are dopes. I'm not so sure. I'm not so sure. Contemporaries of Mr. Pillai tell us that he was academically brilliant, a talented sportsman, and one who stayed away from scraps, which is no mean achievement in Cotton's. I'm sure the diplomatic skills were in place very early. Some seniors also of late claim to have had the unique privilege of having ragged the future Union Home Secretary. But my feeling is that it's a little bit of bravado. Ladies and gentlemen, to more intimately introduce Mr. Pillai to us, I am absolutely delighted to invite on stage someone who knew Mr. Pillai not only in Cotton's, but also through the IAS. Himself a distinguished officer of the IAS, retiring as the secretary Department of Ex-Servicemen Welfare, Ministry of Defense, a 1974 Karnataka Cadre officer, and someone we greatly admire and respect. It gives me tremendous pleasure to invite on stage Mr. S.M. Acharya.
My senior colleague and outstanding personality, Mr. and Mrs. Pillai, I do feel a bit like Gussie Fink Nottle without the charged up lemonade before the speech, because with this galaxy of people from my old school, I do feel a little diffident in addressing all of you in this manner, and especially of one of our brethren who has achieved what certainly is one of the most distinguished positions in our society. Ladies and gentlemen, when I was in school, in Miss Rosario's class, we were made to learn a poem which didn't make very much sense to the 10-year-old that I was at that time. But many years later, that poem seemed to make much more sense, and over a period of time has grown to be a kind of family lifeline which we lived by. I don't know whether I can lay claim to that, to having lived according to the poem, but certainly my knowledge of Mr. Pillai's progression through the service tells me that it is our profession which has helped us a great deal to live by this. If you permit me to quote the last stanza of this poem, the earlier stanzas being equally important, you will realize that speaking to us shortly from now is a person who has achieved much of what this poem prescribes. The poem is titled very shortly, If, and is by Rudyard Kipling, a person who wrote this with a slight sentimental background, which I think you need to know. He had a son who didn't distinguish himself very well in school, but endeavored to try and encourage this son of his to achieve what every man should achieve. And having given him the advice, the good father had this to say in the final paragraph: if you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings nor lose the common touch, if neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it, and, which is more, you'll be a man, my son. He wrote this for a son who needed that encouragement. Ladies and gentlemen, you have heard Aditya guide you through the course of Mr. Pillai's progression through the service and through school. There is, however, to give truth to this last paragraph which I read, an incident which I think I need to share with you, which probably Mr. and Mrs. Pillai would never know about, or would have ever dreamt that it would ever come out before an audience as large as yourselves and as distinguished as yourselves. Many years ago, I had met a group of probationers who were traveling around the country, and they happened to stop by, and I said, well, have you had any good experiences? So a couple of them said, oh yes, indeed, we did. And I said, oh well, would you like to tell me about it? So they said, we landed up in Trivandrum, and we were supposed to be met by the tourism department there to continue with our India Darshan, which most IAS batches go through. And unfortunately for us, we didn't have anybody reach us at the railway station or to take us anywhere. And so we had an address and a number, and we never knew who these people were, and we called up the Pillays. Now, it was late in the evening, apparently, when husband and wife drove up, picked this batch of 13 to 12 student, IAS probationers, attended to their requirements, deposited them where they needed to be deposited, dusted themselves, and got back home as though it was a normal day at work. Well, ladies and gentlemen, this was certainly a most telling incident that remained in my mind, that here are the qualities of a human being that we need to respect and we need to emulate on our own. Leaving that aside, ladies and gentlemen, I would not like to keep you away from a man who has worked in a department which I much admired, and I've too worked in it, and that's the Department of Commerce. Why I make much of this is that I went there as a reluctant and ignorant person, and then realized that this is what made the country tick. The Department of Commerce is a kind of crown jewel department which depends upon the efficient and exact functioning of the entire government of India. And if you can get your colleagues to toe the line that you want them to toe, your work in the Commerce Ministry becomes fruitful and meaningful. And this is what Mr. Pillay had achieved during his tenure. He needed to get people in their roles to perform. You can't put up an SEZ without state governments doing the land acquisition. You can't get apples and tomatoes grown in organic style if you do not have the field functionaries abiding by them. And it is the man at the apex of all this who needs to conduct the entire nation in a deft manner. I certainly would have failed where he has succeeded. Ladies and gentlemen, let me not keep you away from such a distinguished person, and let us listen to an address which is most appropriate for the moment. Thank you very much, and welcome, Mr. Pillay.
Colonel John Ellis, Principal of the Bishop Cotton Boys School, Bangalore, family members of late General K.S. Timaya, patrons, former speakers, trustees, old and present Cottonians, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I'm indeed honored and happy to be back here at Bishop Cotton's. Before I begin, I would like to mention something of what happened in the 1960s, because many of the Cottonians who are studying in the school would not realize what a change has taken place in the last 45 years since I left. When we were in the boarding school, the most interesting, or the most event which we all look forward to was the Saturday afternoon meeting with the warden, at which, when we lined up outside his room for our pocket money, we would get the princely sum of ₹125. That is, 5 4-and-a-half pieces would be the pocket money per week, and ₹5 per month was the maximum pocket money allowed to the students at that time. And what a change we've had from that period till now. I am even more honored that I have been invited today to deliver the General K.S. Timaya Memorial Lecture on India's internal security challenges and responses. General K.S. Timaya's life has always been an inspiration to all Indians. His courage and daring was well known. His tactical brilliance in combat during the Burma operations and in rescuing refugees along with the Punjab Boundary Force has been widely acclaimed. His brilliant tactical maneuvers during what is now considered to be the first Kargil War of 1948 help save Kargil for India. And reading what the colonel of the regiment said, that if he had been allowed to go on to Muzaffarabad, perhaps the Kashmir problem perhaps may not have been there as it was today. I have no hesitation in stating that his tactical brilliance and innovation are not only a source of inspiration, but also something from which we all need to learn from even today. I can recall no better tribute than that of Field Marshal SHFJ Manekshaw, MC, when asked, in his opinion, who had been the best general of the Indian Army, stated, "Timmy, of course, and his word is the last word in the Indian Army." I have been asked to speak on India's internal security challenges and responses. India's internal security challenges arise both from its history and the evolution of democracy in India. The present internal security situation has its history in the formation of the Indian Union and the failure of the Indian democratic process to suitably take care of those marginalized as Indian democracy and the Indian state evolved over the years. If you look at it this way, then the internal security situation can broadly be classified under three major heads: the externally sponsored threats, the secessionist and ethnic identity issues, and the internal armed movements. I will take a minute here If you look at India's historical evolution post-partition, you will find that the initial 10-20 years of all the internal security problems that we had primarily resulted from the problems on the accession of Kashmir and the issues of ethnic identities in the Northeast. We've seen how the partition, the problems of partition, and the fact that in the Northeast, the issue of the Nagas first and then subsequently many of the issues that came up were primarily a result of the government of India, in one sense, failing to understand what I would put it as the ethnic aspirations of the people of the Northeast. We are a very vibrant functioning democracy. There's a lot with which we have to be very proud of. We find that we have taken care of during the Constituent Assembly debates. We managed to be a very inclusive democracy. We made sure that many of the rights of citizens, rights of various groups, were all accommodated. We gave a lot of privileges, as we gave a lot of statutory rights, and the center-state relations itself proved to be of great effectiveness as the Indian polity grew. And we had enough of political space for the states to grow. It is only later in the 73rd and the 74th constitution amendments where we had the Panchayat Raj and the municipal administrations are constitutional. That was the only one sort of, shall I say, a leftover legacy of the Constitution of India. And even that now is slowly getting into place. Most people are not aware that literally more than 1 million women are now in positions of power in lakhs of panchayats and municipalities all over India. For the first time, they are in positions of power. And it's just about 10-15 years since this evolution has taken place, but already the first women leaders from the panchayats have come to become members of parliament. And you will find that in the next decade, next two decades, I have no doubt whatsoever that at least 30, 40, 50 of those women leaders from the panchayats and the municipalities and corporations would come to hold power at the center. I mentioned this, our complex internal security concerns as primarily could be divided into these three sectors, and you will find that for the first, the externally sponsored threats, which is really, in one sense, for us, initially, in the initial years, was all the Pak-sponsored terrorism, the Lashkar-e-Taiba, the Hizbul Mujahideen and other Al-Badr, etc. And today you have the impact of global terrorism, which is the Al-Qaeda, the Taliban and so on. Now, this threat is something which is going to be there. It's going to be there for in the future, and it's something which we will have to live with. I think the world will have to live with. And it is something which, if we do not understand and take care, you will find that we will pay a heavy price. And you will find that just recently you would have seen the FBI has arrested James Hadley, and you will find that what was he doing? He was trying to plan with groups in Pakistan for major attacks in India. And we keep getting these intelligence reports all the time. And it is something which, as I mentioned earlier, later when I discuss the responses, we'll see how some of these are tackled. When you look at the terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir, that despite the significant counterterrorism successes, terrorist groups are still active. We have as much as about 58 terrorist camps in POK and in Pakistan, where training is going on and efforts to push people into Jammu and Kashmir continues literally on a daily basis. Today we find new routes by which these terrorists come in. They don't just come in across the India-Pak border. They are flying in from Islamabad to Kathmandu and then walking across the India-Nepal border, which is peaceful. They're flying from Islamabad to Dhaka and then crossing on the India-Bangladesh border. They're going to Dubai. They're going to the Middle East countries and then flying in, and we have this. What we do see is a possible increase in the foreigner content of the HUM. We're finding that more and more the foreigner content is increasing. If you see terrorism in Jammu and Kashmir and you see the figures, you will find that possibly right now, in 2009, we have possibly the lowest level of incidents and violence for the last almost 15 years. And I must pay for this a great tribute to the Indian Army and to the security forces who've been able to put in a counter-insurgency grid, which has enabled such a situation to take place, and as a result of which there is now today, with a young and very dynamic Chief Minister Omar Abdullah, we're able to find the political space to be able to reach out to the people, provide them the development and the necessary wherewithal to find economic means by which they can need not take arms, but they can do improve their livelihood. Again, it's just on the targeting of whether the SPOs in the police security forces, again, you'll see this. The height of the violence was in those years from 1999 to 2002, and now it's down. You'll see the infiltration routes which are there. It's continuous infiltration which is taking place. Even this year, in spite of all the success that has taken place, you will find that the infiltration attempts has 352 people try to cross over, and even up to August of this year, 91 people have managed to get through. Our rough estimates are that something like about 700 militants are in Jammu and Kashmir who have managed to sneak in over the years, and this is where the counter-insurgency grid is basically trying to control and take care of these people. Training camps, I just wanted to put this figure just to tell you that irrespective of whatever that Pakistan has been talking about and all the pressures, which you really find hardly any impact on any reduction in the number of training camps in POK or in Pakistan, and therefore the threat for us remains extremely cogent. The terrorist strength, as I mentioned, is the different groups. You will find that it's all told, it's about 600 to 700. We have the different groups. And this is what, in basically, insofar as the Jammu and Kashmir situation is concerned, we are in talks with the mainstream and the separatist groups. The talks are, I'm very happy to say, have initiated, and they are continuing. The development initiatives are also in place. We're hoping that the panchayat elections in J&K will take place maybe in January or February of next year. That gives another. And then the rehabilitation of the Kashmiri Pandits, which is a major issue, especially those who have gone to Jammu, and they have to go. And then the healing of wounds. Because any time you have a militancy which lasts for so long, it's inevitable that there are a lot of what I would call as collateral damage which takes place in whatever we do. The reaching out to the people of Kashmir in terms of the healing of wounds, I think the time has come where we are in a position to be able to do so. If I look at the Northeast, and you will find that the situation in Mizoram has been peaceful, Meghalaya and Tripura are stable, the militancy is very little there. We have a ceasefire in Nagaland right from 1997 with the NSE and IM group, and you have Assam and Manipur continue to experience significant violence. And of course, we have the elevated sensitivity of the Siliguri corridor, which is the chicken's neck, and where we are extremely concerned because that's the lifeline for the Northeast. If you look at Nagaland and the conflict, which is the NSE and IM, or the Naga insurgency group, which has been the mother of all insurgency groups in the Northeast, we've had this ceasefire with 1997 and 2000, and today, in spite of all the efforts that we have done, whether it was earlier with the 9-point agreement, the 16-point agreement, and then the 1975 Shillong Accord, we've not had peace in this area, primarily because I think we've never had a peace settlement with all groups together. And today, for the first time, I think, in Nagaland, people are realizing, all the Naga groups are realizing, that until they come together and form one group, until they are in a position where they can put pressure on the militant groups, because the militant groups take a very rigid position, because they think that if they show the slightest possible concession to the government of India, there's somebody who's going to turn around and say, you have betrayed the Naga cause, you have stabbed us in the back. And therefore, it has become very important for us. And when I went to Nagaland just 2 weeks ago, and I met all the groups, whether it was the Naga Hoho, the Naga Mothers Association, the Baptist Council of Churches, the Naga Forum for Reconciliation, and so on, all of them said that we are now in this process of coming together, and we are coming together for one particular purpose, and that is to tell the militant groups, look, you can compromise with the government of India, you can compromise on some of your demands of sovereignty and so on and so forth, and the people of Nagaland are behind you. The Naga people are behind you, and you can do it without being afraid of being called a traitor or being stabbed in the back. And this is something which the process is going on. We are hopeful that there are two clear issues, which is the sovereignty, which is now more or less in one sense gone. The integration of the Naga inhabited areas, a creative solution in one sense, is being formulated for that basis. We have to look at between sovereignty and the freedom concept, which comes out very much in the 9-point agreement for those who have seen. And we are looking at the counter offer, which we hope that we will be in a position to offer to the groups and to all the groups and all the civil society groups before the end of this year. Assam. Assam is, in one sense, it was the mother state. You had, by the time of independence, you had only Assam, and then you had Manipur and Tripura. These are the only other two states. Both Nagaland, Mizoram, and Meghalaya were districts of Assam. And the primary issue was illegal migration. And we call it illegal migration today, but to really understand the historical perspective, this was an area which was short of people. And right from the 1930s, people were actually being asked to come there. People from Bihar, people from the erstwhile East Pakistan and Bangladesh, people from Bengal, were all asked to come. If you see some of the old records, people were actually paid money to go to work in Assam. There was an incentive for people to go. And today we are in a position, we are in the opposite, where we don't want anybody to come. We are saying it's already too many people there, and it's upsetting the balance of the various population groups in Assam. And therefore, the rise of Wulfa came about as a result of their feeling that the Assamese, the Ahoms, are going to be a minority in their own state. And it's a pity that the leaders of Ulfa are actually hiding in Bangladesh. The whole rationale was to say that stop migration from Bangladesh, but they are now taking the protection of the same people to continue their illegal activities from there. And then a host of ethnic identities, which is the Bodo, the Kabis, and the North Kachar, which is the Dimasa groups, and so on and so forth. So you have a whole series of issues which are primarily designed, as I put it, to understand the aspirations of some of these ethnic identity groups. They fear a loss of identity. At the same time, they are now using this to ask for more and more demands from the central government, without realizing that in the long process, in the long term, it is only they who suffer, because they are not able to provide the real stability in that state. Manipur, in one sense, if I may say so, is the most tragic. It's like, Hamlet and Othello. In one sense, it's the most tragic situation. And I think to a certain extent, I think the government of India is primarily responsible for. If you look at the history of Manipur, they're very proud people. They had a kingdom which went back hundreds of years. Culture, art, look at their sports. Even today in the national games, they are number one, number two. 9 out of the 11 members of the women's football team of India is from Manipur. 9 out of 11. World boxing champions, all from Manipur. Cycling, they're the best. And we have not been able in one sense to be able to tap this talent into this. And therefore, with both the accession of Manipur, it's a historical fact, from a kingdom, from a state, or you might call it from a state or a princely kingdom which had a constitution, much before India's constitution, which had a legislative assembly, they became, at the stroke of a pen by the accession, they became a class C state, and an administrator was appointed to rule over that Manipur. And we never learnt the art of understanding what really went wrong with Manipur. And what really happened there thereafter, they had to fight. Nagaland, which was a small district, got a statehood in 1963, where Manipur was still a part of Assam. It was a part of Assam and then became this class C state. They had to fight for years to get recognition of Manipuri as a language in the 8th schedule. Got it only in 1971. Therefore, they realized that you get only something if you really fight, you take arms against the state, then you get something. And that is why, in one sense, when Nagaland became a state and the whole issue of Nagalim, the expanded Naga state came and parts of Manipur were to be pulled in, the Maithi underground groups, in one sense today, are in one sense in the Manipur psyche. Everybody believes that they are there to protect the state's integrity, which is why they have such popular support in one sense at the local level. And the popular support is in one sense so strong that you will find that, I'm just giving an example, the Director General of Police of Manipur, his younger brother would be the head of the underground army. You find ministers, his son-in-law or his son would be in the army, because it's believed that there's a popular upsurge that if the center lets them down, if the territorial integrity of Manipur is not protected, it is only the underground army that will protect the territorial integrity of Manipur. And therefore, they have this very ironic situation between the state and the underground army. And in one sense, what I put, the state in collective depression. You heard people being depressed. I believe that Manipur is a state in collective depression. And those who have ever been depressed likely will understand what I mean. They just don't know what has hit them. They are unable to understand that from a proud history, from a proud civilizational background that they have, where have they landed up, and they don't know what to do. Most people don't realize that for the last 3 months, All schools and colleges in Manipur are lying closed. Again, part of the agitation. Very little notice of that takes place in any of the national newspapers. But if you have 3 months schools and colleges closed, what do the students do? What do the parents do? And this is a real big problem, and it's one of the biggest challenges in the Northeast for the government of India is really Manipur. Broadly, the security situation in the northeastern states is not too bad. You will find that in Assam, the incidents have been very high, primarily because of the incidents in the North Cachar Hills, which was the DHD, Dimasa group. They have now actually laid down arms just earlier this month, and we expect that extrapolated thing will actually come down much lower, because they have now this peace in the North Cachar Hills. And you will find that Nagaland, you see that when I say 24 killed in Nagaland, it's just the factional clashes between the underground, and that is the 24 killed. There are no clashes with the security forces. And Manipur also. Meghalaya is almost negligible. So Tripura is almost, again, killed is zero. Incidents are 23. Arunachal Pradesh, the incidents are just shown as high, but it's hardly just for two districts. Tirap and Changlang is where you have a problem. The same group-wise, if you have it. I then come to what the Prime Minister calls as the most serious security situation. And this is because primarily here, this is what we call as homegrown terrorism. It's come about purely because of lack of governance, or what I should say is the fact that we have left out these people. It started with Naxalism in Naxalbari. Today in Naxalbari, there's no Naxalism there now, hardly any. But the real problem took place with the merger of the CPI-ML and the People's War Group in 2004. This was basically a merger which was very, tactically it was a very significant merger, because you had one group which was the intellectuals group, and on the other group you had which was all the militant group, which are all the arms. And in 2004, when they merged at the party congress in 2004, you had for the first time you had both the intellectuals and the militants coming together. And that has then become, with the birth of the CPI Maoist, has become a very potent force. It is our most dominant group today. It's extremely well organized. It commands the loyalty of 86%. Its weapons, and it's one of the most deployment of IEDs, which is maximum casualties the security forces have had. And their mobilization through front organizations. The front organizations are there widespread all over the country through a variety of organizations who perhaps don't even realize, some of them perhaps, that they are front organizations of the CPI Maoist. So brilliantly has been the ideological underpinnings of the movement. The incidents and killings are on the rise. It's nearing the peak level of 1971. We have 11 states which witness Naxal violence, and there's mobilization in 8 other states. Any state which is violence is very low. In one sense, we should not think that it's because the Maoist influence is not there. It means that they are consolidating, and they will only strike when they are mobilized and when they have got enough strength to be able to strike. You can see the left-wing extremist violence. You will see, if you see the graph, it just shows you how effectively they have been working year after year. It's steady, slowly they have been building up, and I put it always the example of the frog in the water which is boiling. If you throw the frog into boiling water, the frog jumps out. But if you heat it up slowly, slowly, the frog stays there till it gets boiled. And this is exactly, in one sense, the significant strategy of the Maoists. They will not go beyond a point where they feel the state will hit out, just enough to show that they have the influence and be able to take control of the area. And you will find that they've been building up slowly and very steadily. And that is why, in one sense, this is of a great threat, in one sense, to the Indian state if you are not able to tackle this right now. This is just to give you an idea of the spread of the Maoist influence. If you look at it, it's primarily the red corridor, which is Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, and Bihar, which gives them that corridor right across. And then their influence over the other states as they are building up, slowly and very steadily. Don't get misled by the colors, which is just about incidents. It's just showing the area into which, and this is in one sense, for people to understand, this is in one sense the economic heartland of India. This is where almost all the coal, almost all the iron ore, almost all the aluminium, and all your key rail movement, moving the coal, moving iron ore, comes in this area. And the significance of losing control of the heartland is that you can have a 10-day strike in this area, and you will possibly find that in Bangalore or Delhi or Bombay, you will find your power getting hit, because your entire coal, your power plants which depend on coal, would be starved of coal. And the significance of the Maoist threat is that it is now finally, in one sense, in the economic heartland, and it is literally time where the state has underestimated the Maoist threat for a number of years. We are now no longer underestimating it. We are saying this is a potent threat. If you don't take action now, you will be forced to take action at a much higher level of force levels 5 years down the line. And if you don't check it now, you will find that it becomes a major problem. Terrorism in the hinterland, it's something, it's not, I've talked about Kashmir, the northeast, the Maoist area. You will say that how does Bangalore get affected? It's basically because the PAK-based groups are very active. A trend that began has almost got entrenched. A lot of sleeper modules. There's a wide range of targets. You've seen last year when 26/11 took place, how Bombay, Mumbai reacted. And you will find that iconic establishments in Bangalore, whether it's on the western coast, are still a major threat on which we cannot let down our... I'll come to the responses later, so... There is an improved maritime capability of the Lashkar-e-Toiba. They are very... Last time, you're looking at force of 10 people who came across in one boat. The next time it comes, there may be 100 people who will come to 2, 3, or 4 different targets. And it may be a much larger capability which you will then have to respond to, not just the 2 or 3 in a particular place. There are new footholds which the Lashkar-e-Toiba is having in Sri Lanka, Myanmar. And there's increasing sophistication in the communication. Why I particularly mention this is because some of the use of satellite phones, we can trace, intercept the satellite phones, but where the satellite phones are being coming from, they're able to spoof the communication in such a way that the actual location is actually 30, 40 kilometers away, and there's a lot of help which comes from service providers from across the border. Terrorism in Punjab, not major threat yet, but we see an increasing mobilization. Foreign funding and support are increasing. We see some signs, but more worrying in the terrorism threat, and this where it is coming from, is actually the use of drugs in Punjab. The use of drugs is actually going up very high, and most of the drugs are coming from across the border from Pakistan. And that is a little bit worrying because in one sense, both the youth, both boys and girls in Punjab are getting affected by this. The management of India's borders. For those who have seen the map of India, and you see this, we have almost 15,000 kilometers of land border, and possibly half, little less than half, is the maritime borders. It's a huge area for us. Insofar as the India-Pakistan border is concerned, well defended, you have the army or you have the BSF, you have fencing, flood lighting and so on to a certain extent. They're reasonably well protected. But if you look at the India-Nepal border, it's totally blank. Because the 1950 Indo-Nepal treaty, friendship treaty, we allow people from India and Nepal to cross the border without a visa. You can just cross across. And people from Nepal, in fact, can come and even take jobs in India, and no problems at all. But now that we see this movement from Pakistan into Kathmandu and then the misuse of the open borders, it is time for us now to see how best. These are all medium-term strategies. The India-Bangladesh issue is a major one. It's not so much a threat in terms of the security threat as such now, because most of the migration which is taking place is on economic grounds. People are coming from Bangladesh to India for jobs. And I was reminded in one sense of on the issue of climate change, and you people are saying there's a earlier study of the, I think it was the Scientific American, I think, which said that by 2050, about one third of Bangladesh will be underwater. And then you are going to have 50 million people are going to, where will they go? The only place is to go is India. So India is the place from where they will come to. It's the importance of climate change, both on internal security and on our economic development is really going, that's the type of impact that is going to be there. Therefore, the management, India-Myanmar border is also porous, it's open. As per the border treaty, people can cross the border into India up to 40 kilometers for the local people. And you don't have the India-Bhutan border is relatively peaceful, but you still have militants using parts of the Bhutan forest on the other side. And now I come to basically what do we do? What are our responses going to be? All of us have realized the world over, and it's almost unanimous through all counterterrorism forces across the world, the importance of intelligence. Because as I mentioned, if you have 15,000 kilometers of land border, you have a floating population, migration taking place, etc., intelligence is most critical for us. It's not only the intelligence, therefore, post 2611, we set up what are called as multi-agency centers or MAC, MAC, to coordinate intelligence inputs. So every day today, both in the center and in the states, the heads of all intelligence, whether it's IB, whether it's RAW, it's special branch, anybody, all of them are meeting to share whatever intelligence they have of that day. In fact, the Home Minister takes a meeting every day where the National Security Advisor, the Home Secretary, the Director of Intelligence Bureau, Secretary, RAW, Chairman, JIC meet. Every day for 45 minutes we meet, share, understand what is the implications of the intelligence that everybody is bringing in, and then try to see what is the further follow-up, what are the leads which are we feel are useful, which are not so useful. As somebody put it the other day when the FBI was interrogating that American, he said, what was the communication on the telephone to somebody in Pakistan? We are going to India to say hi to Rahul. And then the issue became, what does that mean? Now somebody finally, after a lot of this thing, we are saying it means an Indian actor in Bombay. Who is Rahul? Earlier it started by the Rahul Gandhi, Rahul Bose, Rahul Khanna, and so on and so forth. And then finally people are now veering round to the view that possibly could be Shah Rukh Khan, because his name has been Rahul in a number of movies in which he's acted. So that is a way in which the intelligence you are assessing, and you're trying to see what is he really trying to say. And the sifting through of intelligence is something which we need to, which is why a team from Government of India is actually should be on its way to the United States to interrogate these two people who have been detained in America, to find out more about what some of the code words were and so on. We are setting up a national intelligence grid. It's basically getting all the intelligence from, whether it's the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence, the banking system, the IB's reports, the military intelligence and so on, getting them all together into one intelligence grid. The National Counterterrorism Center is something which is also coming up. It is basically, the system is basically such that, I'm giving an example from what the Americans have, and to a certain extent we are modeling it on that pattern. They have 32 major sources of information, intelligence is gathered. And all those 32 agencies sit in one building. And they have people from all these agencies full time. They work 24 hours, so they have people full time. You have 8 people, and they work for 12-hour shifts, and they come 3-4 days a week, and all the intelligence which comes in from all these agencies. And I can tell you how effective the American intelligence agencies are, because they are much more wired society than India is. We just had somebody, and I can tell you it was one of our IT companies, I don't want to mention their name, between two accounts people, they were sharing their, there's a telephone conversation in Los Angeles, and they were saying that a bill of materials has not come. And they said the bill of materials has not come, quickly send it. And they have an acronym, so it's called BOM. So he said, bomb name mila, jildi bomb, you know, bezo. And believe me, within hours, the FBI man was at their door to ask them what bombs were they talking about. And these poor account people did not even know what was happening. But that is the level of the communication which they are monitoring. They've got a whole set of catchwords. If you use BOM, bombs, hijack, explosions, murder, you know, Al-Qaeda, Osama, you know, any type of code words, which are hundreds of them, the system just throws it up and says, this word was spoken by somebody in this telephone or this, using this internet. I hope many of you know that every single word which you put on the internet, any message you send on the email, is monitored. Every single thing is monitored. If it comes from India, it is monitored from India. If it's gone United States, because bulk of the servers are there, they monitor it. Because even a message which you send, sometimes it doesn't, all of you know, it goes to a server in the United States, and from there it comes back. You're sending a message to your friend in Mumbai, it doesn't go from Bangalore to Mumbai, it goes from Bangalore to America and then from America to Mumbai. And therefore the server there, the monitoring is done there. And it's available, because you will find in the FBI, it's on the website. Look at how they have intercepted all the emails from this James Hadley to his friends in Pakistan. Every single message is being monitored. And I don't think it's a secret. I think if you are in any office here, and if you think you are not being, I think you are being monitored by your head of your office. They are monitoring what you are doing in your spare time. If you are sending any mails, I think they are all monitoring it. That's part of the security culture that's developed. We've set up the regional hubs of energy. We saw in Mumbai last time, we took a long time to react. We've got energy hubs now at Mumbai, Kolkata, Chennai, and Hyderabad. Possibly a few more will need to come to in some other areas where we see an emerging threat which is taking place. It's a setting up of quick reaction teams. You have the training of these quick reaction teams is very important. And more important than the setting up of the quick reaction teams is the mobilization and the mock drills that they do. It's very important for them to keep doing these drills, because if you don't do the drills, you don't know what to do when the real emergency takes place. And to just give you a simple example, in Delhi we did a mock drill. And when we did, we have quick reaction teams which are ready at, you know, people are dressed, bulletproof jackets, weapons at the disposal. And within 30 seconds of the beep, they're supposed to be on their feet with their weapons and rushing to the vehicles to move. When we did the drill, we found 30 seconds with 2 minutes, they were inside the vehicle. But we found the vehicle didn't move. Why? Because the driver has gone for tea. So what is the lesson that you learn? The lesson you learn is, make sure that when you have these quick reaction teams, the driver must sit in the vehicle. He wants to go for tea. Tea must be served to him in the vehicle. If he has to go to the washroom, please make sure another driver sits in his place. And every, you know, 30 minutes, he is to start the vehicle to see that it's at the time when you want an emergency, the vehicle starts and does not start. Now, these, you can only do these if you have these mock drills and all the time. You have to practice. It's like in your school. If there is a, God forbid it doesn't happen, but if you were to have a terrorist attack in this school, what are your drills that you have? Where is your evacuation? What is your threat? And you have this type of unless you keep planning this, and it is being done. I can tell you that some of the schools, the security drills are being done. I'll come back. We've sanctioned a number of counterinsurgency and terrorism schools, new battalions, sanctioning of India Reserve battalions. See, the modernization of the state police force is taking place through better weapons, augmenting the coastal security through purchase of these high-speed interceptor boats, the process of issuing identity cards to all residents of coastal villages, procurement of helicopters, and what we call the safe megacity policy, which is really the, in the long term, you have to protect the entire city. You can't protect every institution. You can't protect every colony by building a gated wall around it and you think you are safe. So the whole safe city policy is something which we are working on now, and we hope to be able to roll that out over the next, it will take about 3 to 5 years to make the whole city safe. Delhi is, in one sense, slightly more advanced. Next year's Commonwealth Games, the safe city policy will get into effect for Delhi for the Commonwealth Games. We set up the National Investigation Agency and the strengthening of state police forces. The strengthening of state police forces is so important, and you wonder why state governments have been so remiss in augmenting state police forces. The vacancies, and I'm only talking of vacancies, in the sanctioned strength of state police forces, the vacancies, and the sanctioned strength is also very low. I'll come to that later. In the sanctioned strength, the vacancies are in excess of 3 lakhs. 3 lakh policemen are short in the state police forces. And I think it's a criminal neglect by the state governments. Because if you don't have policemen, which are already very low, with in police station of 1 plus 12, where you need 1 plus 40, you are not able to. And this is something post 26/11 we are pushing. We've got now about 80,000 policemen which have been recruited since 26/11 and getting trained. We're building up the police training institutes to be able to give them the better training. And the average for India is 125 policemen per a lakh of population. Desirable for India is about 225. Developed countries have about 550. And in states like West Bengal, it is 76. In Bihar, it is 56. If you have only 56 per lakh population, you are just inviting other groups to be able to come in and take control of the area, because there is no police force at all present in vast stretches of these areas. Media management is something which is important. You've seen in 26/11 itself, and then how the importance of that. And then the laying down the standard operating procedures for different situations. It's very important. The armed forces, I must say, are possibly the one force which has the maximum number of standard operating procedures for this. And we need to lay down the standard operating procedures, which is for every school, every mall, every metro, this standard operating procedure, what is to be done in the event of an emergency. Otherwise, you will find that when the actual emergency takes place, you found that in 26/11, when it took place in Mumbai, you found the DGP went one place, the Commissioner of Police went another place, and the head of the anti-terrorism squad, he put on his bulletproof jacket and he went another place. And then you'll never be able to have a coordinated response. And that is because you don't have the standard operating procedures. As we keep telling in the Home Ministry, if you have an emergency, you get a call wherever you are, what are you supposed to do? And people will say 101 things. We say the first important thing for you is to please rush to the control room. You come to the control room, assess the situation, and then your standard operating procedure should fall into place automatically. And they only fall into place automatically if you've done all these mock drills and you've done all these steps one by one so that you really don't have a problem. And I just thought I'll just broadly, quickly, just flag some of the issues which are the non-military, militancy, internal security situations, governance issues. The governance issues is very, very critical. Most of these areas, internal security problems have arisen because of especially those areas which are far away from urban centers. People don't want to go. Who do you post to Chhattisgarh, Dantewada district? You post the person, it's a punishment posting for him. So if you post somebody as punishment posting for him, he goes there, he's already disgruntled. He says, somebody, I have not been able to manage a posting in the state capital. I've got posted to this remote area. He goes and takes it out on the local people. And the local people are the ones who suffer the most. If I were to tell you that there are some areas in Orissa and there are some areas in Madhya Pradesh, to which no government servant, no government institution, no government person has ever seen them for the last 40 years. In 1970, a dam was built near Malkangiri in Orissa. As a result of the dam, the flooding came, and 142 villages were on the other side of the dam. Today is 2009. I don't know those 142 villages, what those people do. They just vanished off the national radar scene. No government, no village, no police station, no thana, no village, nothing else. And it still continues even today. And the Maoists have got into those areas and they won't even allow you to come in now. Now if you try to, you have to build a bridge to cross across. Every time you want to build a bridge, they try to blow up the bridge. Because that's one of their bases. And you got in the Abujmad forest in Dantewada, 9,000 square kilometers of area where we don't know what's happening. So that's huge areas which are outside the, shall I say, the grip of the state administration. That's why governance issues are very, very critical, and how to handle governance in most of these isolated pockets. How do we make sure that a school teacher goes there? How do we make sure that a doctor goes there? How do we make sure that a policeman goes there? How do we make sure that roads are built and so on and so forth? It's a very critical issue. Population migration, important. Not only Bangladesh, we have 1 lakh Sri Lankans now as refugees in Tamil Nadu. We've got Bhutanese, Bhupalese, from Nepalese origin. We've got various people from Chin to Tibetans to, you know, everybody's, and it's an issue which will be an issue of internal security problem in some areas. Cyber terrorism is another big area which is going to come. We have to prepare ourselves for that. Environmental degradation is important in terms of the making sure that you don't pollute by the industries into the various river systems and so on. Climate change, I mentioned, it's primarily going to affect in terms of is our water. I think the most important thing for India in the next 10, 20 years is going to be water. You're going to be fighting over water. You know, in Karnataka, you know how you have been fighting over the Kaveri water and so on and so forth. And this issue is going to become more and more important, and something which is very important for us to be able to do the rainwater harvesting, conserve water as much as possible, is going to be one of the big internal security challenges in the coming years to come. Organized crime is the linkage which is there. And then the fake Indian currency notes, which is being now flooded in quite a bit, but not, it's something which, and it's all done by Pakistan. They're producing very high quality notes, and we are taking some steps to make sure that in future, in a few years' time, we produce all the notes in India and have the safety measures in place so that we are able to avoid some of the problems which come because we are getting the similar type of printing press and similar paper from people abroad who Pakistan are also buying from. Thank you. And I think I've given you an...
privilege for us that we have an old boy at the helm of affairs. To the young Cottonians, I don't know how much of this registered, but if nothing else, certainly take note of the fact that we're bringing before you role models and idols. You've got one in Mr. Pillay. If any of you aspire to be an IAS officer, It doesn't get better than this. Ladies and gentlemen, we will be able to spare about 20 minutes for a quick Q&A. It's up for grabs, but kindly do introduce yourself before you ask a question, and then kindly keep your question or your comment as brief as possible. We'll start from the front. Suchin.
Thank you, Mr. Pulle, for a very, very wide canvas and candid discussion. I have a question coming out of two points. First is what I like to call the Strathonian principle, the ostrich with its head in the sands. Now, we have seen for many years now that the Green Corridor has been attributed to a proxy war by Pakistan. But it's not so difficult to connect the dots when it comes to the Maoists. We have definitely have to have an external source of arms. It is known that when there is a war against any state, all the anti-state actors do collaborate in one way or another. And yet we see that India supported the Maoists in Nepal, and to the extent of getting the Anglo-American support. Now, is not the Red Corridor a proxy war by China? And the second issue has to do with the Manipur syndrome. Ever since independence, we've seen that the application of Indian laws have been selective and applied in accordance with political whims. And to the extent that today, from being a functioning anarchy, we have evolved into being a mockery of the rule of law. Now, both these issues, to my mind, seem to indicate the need for political will and rapidity of response. Now, what hope do we see for that?
See, I think, we keep saying lack of political will all the time. And I think political will comes only when people get together and put enough pressure. Nothing comes until the people have to move. Therefore, it's so important in a democracy that you have to move, you have to protest, you have to put your pressure on. It's not somebody else is going to do. Political will never come on its own. The politician only comes if he feels that he's going to lose a vote bank. And which is why you will find that, say, police reforms. You have 3 lakh policemen. I would have thought 3 lakh jobs for a chief minister, if he had given jobs, he would have thought that it's a good thing, would give him votes. But it's still not happening. Police reforms, they don't see it as that if you provide good security, it's going to get me votes. He thinks he can always buy your votes up during time of elections. And if you can convince the politician that I'm going to vote for the politician who's going to give me a secure life, and that's going to be a political force, then you will find that police reforms will become number one priority. I think today, if you want to put on the political parties any agenda, police reforms is, I think, number one. But you will only get that when the political class realizes that this is, it's also vote bank politics. The second, I think, is, I think we've all made mistakes. I think I don't think the Indian state has not made its mistakes. Even the LTT was supported, we're all aware, we supported it, turned out to be we are realizing that. I think in the last few years, we have realized that it doesn't pay. And to that extent, I think it's a good sign. Rule of law is something which is very important for us. You've seen the judicial system, which has collapsed under the weight of what we call as delays in cases. There are some people who are interested in the delay, and it's always the strong which is interested in the delay, because you will find that the strong always manage to get away. And it's the weak that always suffer when delay takes place. Which is why I'm also Secretary of Justice. By a strange historical, the Home Secretary is also Secretary of Justice, and we had the national consultation on reducing delays and so on and so forth. And we've now come up with a target. I don't know how much, but at least we said all delays, which are now about 15 years, is the average delay which takes place in courts, to be reduced to 3 years. And government itself is the largest. 60% of all cases in courts in India today, government is either the party or the respondent. So government itself has to become a responsible litigant, and if you can just eliminate, if somebody has made a genuine decision, Why do we go on appeal to the district court, the high court, the Supreme Court? Because it doesn't cost me any money, therefore all government servants go in appeal right up to the Supreme Court. So responsible litigant policy is also coming today. And if that comes, you can then reduce the number of cases, at least by, I think, at least a crore of cases can go in the next 6 to a year. And that policy is now being put into place, and we hope that we'll be able to bring it down, if not, at least we hope, 3 years, to bring everything down to 3 years.
Anil.
My name is Anil Jain. You said the Maoists are very well organized, but seeing how large an area there is there some central command? And you know, what sort of organization do they have? And the other question is, how much are the Maoists, the whole Maoist movement, because of economic factors or you know, economic deprivation of the population there?
Yeah, the Maoists have a Politburo and they have a central military command. So that is the real, as I mentioned, that's the think tank which is really operating across this. And I've just got your second question. Yeah, I think the factors, they start by exploiting, economic problems that have come in. And then after a time when they have dominated that area, you will find that, if you read the June 14th, their post-election manifesto of the Maoist Party, and it's on the website, so people should be able to read that. It's a 22-page document setting out what their philosophy is. And it is armed movement, armed. They're not talking of a democratic, armed movement to overthrow the state. So they're looking at 10 years, 15 years, 20 years time. They want to rule India after having, through an armed revolution, thrown the government. That's the aim. It starts with an economic deprivation, but once, I'm just giving an example. If there's a grievance somewhere, I'm just saying a village officer in some place is exploiting the people, or he's corrupt. What they come there to do is, they come there and then that village officer is then caught by the Maoists, because he's in an isolated, these are all in first, started off in the isolated areas. They catch the village officer, they tie him to a tree. And then they tell the villagers, you've been exploited by this man, go and beat him up. And all the villagers beat him up, they feel empowered. See, for 20 years, 30 years, the village officer has been, you know, he's the feudal, you know, he's been able to harass them by their records and so on and so forth. Or you look at the forest rights, which is why it's so important now as part of the Forest Rights Act. The tribals in the forest have the rights to all the minor forest produce. The forest officer, the ranger, books cases. Oh, you've plucked this leaf from here, you've plucked that from this thing, and books a case against them. Now the Forest Rights Act itself says that you can't book. The tribal has the right to all these. And therefore, large number of, I think hundreds of thousands of cases against the tribals have now all to be withdrawn from the courts. And if we are able to do that, the harassment stops. And then they use this as a base, and once they've established a base, the Maoists then don't allow anybody else, then you have no dissent. You have dissent only while they are up. Once they have captured dominant force in that area, they don't allow anybody else. If you then say something else which they do, is you say that is wrong, they just kill you. And the large number of killings that have taken place are all, they say that you are a police informer and they kill you. That's the problem.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Pillai, for your extremely informative talk. My name is Dr. Shastri. I consider myself an amateur expert on Pakistan. You spoke of media management, and what I particularly find distressing is the fact that the population of Pakistan for the last 30, 35 years, the children in schools, I'm not talking about madrasas, they've been taught that India is the enemy, Hindus are enemies, they are bad. Pakistanis in their 30s, who are getting up to senior ranks in the army as well, are growing up with this attitude. And there's a remarkable ignorance of this among the people of India. And don't you think the government of India really should be a little bit more open, get hold of a couple of textbooks from Pakistan, publish it and say, this is what Pakistan is doing, and hold them to account? Why is this not happening?
I think you're right. There is a lot of brainwashing which is being done in Pakistan. Very difficult for us in one sense to be able to handle that. The only way now is with the internet and so on and so forth, is to be able to put an alternate scenario before them. And this is what we have seen in Kashmir itself. There are a lot of people in Kashmir, first they were all wanting to say, let's go with Pakistan. But today, I think if you go, then you'll find hardly anybody in Kashmir who says, we want to be part of Pakistan. They've seen what is happening in Pakistan. They've seen the, you know, the, literally the disintegration, what they're doing in the Swat Valley and South Waziristan. There's very little. So that has already gone. They still have the, some of them who want to say that we would still like to be independent. That's the media which you have to say that there are a lot of things which are good in India. I think there are too many things which are good in India, which people are not realizing. And I think that is something which we really need to have a real media campaign on that.
Yeah, Chakra.
Thank you, sir. My name is Chakrapani. I passed out in 67. So my question is only this, that after the number of people who died 26/11 in Bombay, what is our response? What should our response be? No doubt the case is still being tried, but still we know who's behind it. Everybody knows behind it. And still we keep quiet. I mean, if we have agreed to something with the United States of America, there should be some quid pro quo for that agreement, isn't it? Thank you.
I think the Mumbai, at least the case which is on, we hope it's almost in its final stages, and it's for the judiciary to decide, but we hope that we can get a judgment out as quickly as possible against the one sole surviving terrorist and the others. There are still five other accused who are in Pakistan. You know how it is. They are still not started their trial yet. It shows how insincere the Pakistanis are. But they have got, I think the world is aware that the type of compulsions that they have, it's so mixed up between them, between the state and the non-state actors, that they have a major problem in handling their internal situation. But if you say we should have taken a far more stronger line, I think I would have said yes. But I think to an extent, we are India. I think we are much more circumspect in our actions than many other countries like America would do.
Yeah, I'll come to
Mr. Pillai, thank you so much for that very informative talk. My name is Advit. I passed out in 2002. I have two questions. The first question is regarding the Maoists. Where are they getting their funding from? And is China have any role to play in it? And where are they getting their arms supply? And who's running the whole thing? The funding, the arms, and all that. And my second question, following up on Sir's previous question, he spoke about why India can't take some tough action and do something. I feel that why can't we, do some covert operation in Pakistan and take out some top terrorists? We always think of the consequences. Oh, if we go in there and, snipe out a few top Lashkar terrorists or some of the most wanted, oh, what's going to happen? What will be the political consequences? What will be the diplomatic consequences? But when the terrorists plan a strike, they never think of the consequences. They just go and strike. So why can't we just go out there and take out some a top few terrorists and send a message? Thanks.
First, I think the funding, all the funding is basically by the governments, because all the money that terrorists get are from the extortion money which they take from the government itself. That's always been there, whether it's Jammu and Kashmir, whether it's been northeast, whether it's in the Maoist area. It's a whole cottage industry of extortion right across. You're not so familiar with it in Bangalore, or Bengaluru as we would say it. But in Nagaland, every government servant pays 25% of his one month's salary as tax to the underground. Every government servant. So all movement, you get trucks which are moving. If you cost a truck from Guwahati to Dimapur, it costs 3,000 rupees. From Dimapur to a district, it costs 15,000 rupees. So cost of cement, which you getting 250 rupees. The cost of bag of cement there is 550 rupees. And that's where the underground gets its funding from. So for every contractor, from every movement which is coming in on trucks and so on and so forth. So if you want to put it, it's the government of India that is financing the terrorism. There's nobody else. It's that way. And the arms, I think the arms are, the arms industry in the world is possibly the one of the largest. It's the Americans, the Chinese, the Pakistanis, the Iranians, you name it. All of them have tremendous, you go to any of the places, you go to Chittagong, you go to Bangkok, you go to parts of China and so on and so forth. Arms are available literally off, and it's just available. You just have the money, you can get any type of weapon, any type of this thing, it's available. It's the arms business is one of the most lucrative and thriving businesses in the world, and it's very easy to get it. And it's you can get it from, if you have the money, and you can get it. And you are getting the money from the extortion. And a lot of people pay. Many big industrial houses, everybody pays because you've made your big investment and then you don't want to lose the money. So everybody pays in small bits and pieces till it adds up to a huge figure. They take Nagaland itself, the average NSCNIM average budget because is about 700 crores. So they get 700 crores every year from what the money we give to the state. So that's the type of money. And in the Maoist areas, the same thing. I think there's a whole pile of all the mining areas, all the corporations which are in the steel sector, etc. I think all of them, in one sense, are paying protection money. Yeah, I think the second action, I think, is of why don't we do covert action and so on and so forth. I think the real answer is that if you do a covert action, you should know about it.
Your talk was very illuminating, sir. My name is Dr. Chengappa, passed out in 1974 from Cotton's. I have a small question on internal security, since I write on the issue very often. Today, the problem is the police forces in the country are not combatized. And therefore, why is the defense minister constantly making contradictory statements against the use of the army and the air force in the fight against nationalism? Thank you.
I don't think he's making contradictory statements. I think what he's really saying is that you don't need to use the army and the air force at this stage of the operations. It's much better that it's handled by the state police forces and the paramilitary forces. And it will take some time. As I said, the strengthening of the state police forces are being done. They are undergoing training in many combat institutions, and they are some of them are being trained in, even in some of the army schools, so that they are being trained in jungle warfare and so on and so forth. But it takes time. It's not easy to, it takes years of training before you can come to the standards which the, or even near what the army has.
Yeah. I'm General Raghunath. Thank you, Mr. Pillai, for a very nice talk. To what extent is the drug traffic significant as far as breeding terrorism, and particularly in Manipur, it seems to be a very important aspect.
Well, in Afghanistan, as you know, the entire thing is all the opium traffic is the one that's feeding terror. For, I mean, the all the financing which is being done. It's done. I think even in Manipur, there is a certain element of, but I would put it as something like between 15%, I don't think more than 15% is drug money. The rest is all extortion money.
Yes, yes, Mr. Pillai. My name is Francis Rego. I've been your master in 1960. 1960 as a young boy, I've seen you with a baggy pant and a very smart and a very, very clever boy you were. All I want to ask you is, when you don't have peace at home, do you expect peace elsewhere? You don't expect anywhere. But I've seen every state is fighting. Infighting is going on. Right now, in Bangalore, you can see what colossal loss is going on. Every state is having a fight. Interfight, fighting one another, caste, creed, party, and everything.
What is the Home Department is doing? Why can't a Home Department have interstate Peace Corps? That means everybody must come under the Peace Corps and try to rectify ourselves before we rectify somebody else. We are showing that we are fighting all the time. Every state is fighting. Very, very sad. Absolutely sad. Millions and millions of money is just going out. What are we trying to do? In a very small place we find differences of people. But how are we going to keep this 1 billion people at peace? All that we have to do, you have to interact, you have to show love and affection to one another, then only you will be able to do. But any time, just now, day before yesterday, I saw in the paper, the Chief Minister has transferred hundreds of people overnight, different places. That is the way to go on. How will one will work? Unless if Mr. Pillai has kept for 5 years in a place, he will be able to exactly extract, do the work and comply with the work. Otherwise, it is very difficult. Thank you, Mr. Pillai.
No, I agree with you. I think we need far more understanding and tolerance and of each other. But I'm being a little bit of a practical realist. I think societies are in transition today. We are just about 60 years into what I call as the idea of India. We've always said we've got a civilizational unity, but we don't have that, you know, the whole territorial unity has yet to come. So we are in the process of learning, understanding different groups are jockeying for power, for prestige, for opportunities and so on and so forth. And I think schools have a tremendous basis because I think in one sense, it's a new generation. We are a young nation. You know, 65% of our population are below the age of 30. So it's the younger generation which is really going to make all the change. And they have tremendous aspirations. They want change much faster than we wanted. And I think the change is going to come, and the youngsters will have to do far more in reaching out to each other. I think they'll use the internet, they'll use Facebook, YouTube, and so on and so forth. But you need to reach out. But I cannot foresee a situation where tensions will come down. I think for the next 10, 15, maybe a couple of decades, tensions are going to rise because there are people who are what I call as words, relative deprivation. See, you may be deprived, but so long as you don't think you are deprived, you accept what it is. Today with TV, media, people are seeing much more. They're seeing that somebody else is, the opportunities they're seeing, and they want a piece of that. And therefore, when they want a piece of that, you will find a little bit of tensions coming, and how best we can manage that tension is really the success of governance.
Gurdeep.
I'm Gurdeep Singh, class of 65. It's good to see Mr. Rego looking much younger than many of us, though he's taught most of us. Anyway, back to the subject. With the turmoil that is going on in Pakistan with these suicide bombings and attacks on the civil locations all over Pakistan, what are the possibilities and realities of the situation as far as India is concerned in relation to that? Can we expect that to overflow into our country, and what is the preparedness in that situation? Thank you.
I think we can expect some of that to overflow into India. There's no doubt about it. It's going to take place. We have to be prepared. That's one of the things which are doing. If you say, are we fully prepared? I would say no, but we are slightly better prepared than we were a year ago. It takes time to build up the capabilities because it's finally a lot of it is human intelligence and human people who are going to do. And that part of training and the organization is will take time. So, but we are taking whatever we can, and it's something on which. We can't rest. It's something for us. It's a 24/7 job all throughout, and everybody has to be vigilant. It's at every level. It's not government in one sense. Government can be. At every level, people have to be vigilant to see how, in your own office, in your own this thing, you see that particular type of behavior, which is. I think you need to take the natural precautions, and. I think government will be far more effective and far more responsive to the next incident. But whether we can prevent it, that's good intelligence. If we are able to get that good intelligence, we'll try to prevent it. One of the reasons why between 2611 and now we've not had is the fact that we something like about 27 terror modules have been broken up in India, and one of the kingpins, I can tell you very clearly, is Mr. Madani, who was arrested. I think he was the head of one of the largest spy modules here, and his arrest and detention in India has really, in one sense, busted up most of the rings, and it'll take some time for them to be able to reorganize and, you know, but if they're going to reorganize, they're going to come back again, and we have to be vigilant and on our guard.
General Paul.
Thank you, Mr. Pillai. It was a very informative talk, even to us. I'd like to say that after hearing you in details, I don't see any difference between the condition in Pakistan and in our country today. I'd particularly like to know what's your view about it. Secondly, if we know that somewhere nobody has gone for 40 years, then there must be some time-bound program to retrieve the whole situation. Not that I know you must be doing your best, and there is no political will or some such thing. But what does the administration as such do? How much power they have to alert the politicians and see that we do something? Where we haven't gone for 40 years, particularly, what is the time frame for doing something? Thank you.
I don't think between India and Pakistan, I think there's a veil of a difference. I think both in our democracy and rule of law, and I think you have the there. Pakistan is it's a military state. The military has an overwhelming dominance in that area, not just the army itself, but the army controls a lot of the economy in Pakistan. A lot of the factories, land, and so on is controlled by the army. It's not that way in India. But I think the problem for India is that we still don't, in one sense, we still haven't fully got our act together. It's everybody. I'm just giving an example. You saw the Rajdhani when it was blocked. And what is happening? Somebody is the West Bengal government says Mamata is for the powers, the Mamata TNC says it is with this and so on and so forth. They are Maoists, you are Maoists, and so on and so forth. Finally, everybody is a Maoist. So what are you fighting for? We are all Maoists. So, nobody is that, that unity of purpose has still not come because people are still looking at very narrow ends. And I think that's why I said we are still not that consensus that this is a major threat has still not come. It is going to come as I think in the next 3 months and maybe next 6 months, it depends on how it's going to come. But it has to come for everybody to be able to, have that unity of purpose. Otherwise, different people say, no, it is, somebody says the Maoists are okay, somebody says something is there, everybody has different views. That's the beauty of democracy, different views are and you have to take it. But at some point of time, you have to say that this is it. And don't wait for that. Sometimes we are, people say in India we really come together only when there's a total crisis. We allow a situation to develop to such a situation that, finally if the army has to come in or somebody has to come in and then everybody works. But you need to come to that situation. Can we get our act together before that? And that's really the question before us.
Friends, since we're running short of time, maybe we can take 3 or 4 more questions. Unless the boys want to ask a question each. Yeah.
My name is Wing Commander Samsi, retired. And my question is slightly different in the sense that it's a perception from our neighbors. And I happened to be in Dhaka last year, January, that's 2008. And there was a conversation amongst 3 gentlemen. One was the retired High Commissioner of Bangladesh to India, who was there between the BJP government and the UPA government. And there was a retired Bangladesh general and a businessman. Now, the businessman asked a question, and I think he had a great sense of humor. He asked a question to the general and to the retired High Commissioner. He says, How long will India take to overrun Bangladesh? So they were all stumped. And then the businessman himself came with an answer, 2 days. And this surprised the general. So he says, how 2 days? He says, the Indian army will just take 2 days to prepare and then Bangladesh will be overrun. So this is, then the Bangladesh High Commissioner asked, he says, well, it could be true, but it may not be true also. And he said that the Bangladesh government is trying to establish relationship with India. It didn't succeed because of, you know, religious reasons for which during the BJP government, and the UPA government did try to establish relationship in Kalidas' time, but she was not very keen. Then they turned around and asked me, he says, what does India look for in Bangladesh? And like an ordinary citizen, I said, we look for stable neighbors and the prosperity of all the neighborhood countries. And my question is related to this, and I'm sure something is being done, that what steps is the government taking to for the stabilization of our neighbors? I'm sure something must be done, because it's the instability of these countries which is causing great threat to us.
I think I agree with you that I think we need stable neighbors, we need peaceful neighbors. To that extent, it is in India's interest to have a prosperous Bangladesh. A not so prosperous Bangladesh means that more Bangladeshis will come into India for jobs. So rather than having a million Bangladeshis come into India, in which case I have to provide the housing, the schooling, everything, that's a cost. It's perhaps much more important for us to perhaps give that much of a grant in Bangladesh and have economic development so that they stay there and, you know, prosper within Bangladesh. Because that, nobody likes to leave his village, you know, and come and settle down in a slum or something in India. They're coming purely out of economic considerations. That, say 99% are coming on economic grounds. So if you, it is in India's interest. That is why we have, with, you know, on the trade itself, duty-free access for all Bangladesh goods to come in, so that more people can work in Bangladesh, produce the goods and sell them to India. And I think as a country we can take that much. We don't have to worry. We were at one time worried about that the flood of Bangladesh textiles to India would harm Indian textile industry. But I think we are a large enough country to be able to absorb whatever they can produce. They do export also. So I think I agree with you. It's in our interest, long-term interest, to really see that our neighbors prosper. Because if our neighbors don't prosper, I think we will also not prosper.
So there's a question here at the back.
Sir, I have two questions which are very relevant to your home ministry. My name is Mohanlal. I am retired. I have taken voluntary retirement from government service. Which is the first question is about the physical preparedness of our security forces. Perhaps you will appreciate that there is a physical efficiency test conducted when a soldier is taken in the Indian Army. When an officer is taken in the Indian Army, there is a physical test, efficiency test conducted. Likewise, in Indian police force, when constables or sub-inspectors are taken, there is a physical efficiency test conducted before they are made cleared, they are cleared for the appointment. Similarly, even some of the states where deputy superintendent of police are taken directly by the state governments, then also the physical efficiency test is a must before they are taken into service. Whereas it is a paradox that Indian police service, when officers are directly recruited, there is no physical efficiency test conducted even till this date for such officers. Please offer your comments on this. Number two is that in awarding the national awards like Padma Shri, Padma Bhushan, Bharat Ratna, I am sure that Ministry of Home Affairs got a very good say in it. In fact, the Ministry of Home Affairs clear the names, then only it is published, I am sure about it. Now, some of the wrong people have got into the recent list. For example, I will tell you, Mr. Harbhajan Singh, the cricketer, has openly slapped Mr. Shishant, cricketer, in the field. The very same year, he has been awarded Padma Shri by the Government of India. Please offer your comments. Thank you.
I think the IPS, that issue of physical test is already, we are already in discussions with the UPSC to prescribe a physical test for the IPS officers before they are. We are in final stages. We hope for the 2010 recruitment there would be a physical test for the IPS officers. So that is being taken care of. I think the other one on the Padma Awards, I'd rather not say, because it's not just a committee with the Home Ministry, of course, takes, but there's a group of 10 people, experts, who decide, and then it goes right up to the Prime Minister and the President to decide. So I think we'll leave it at that.
So we have a question from a present Cotonian here.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Rahul Perera. I'm a present Cotonian. My question is on this fact. Much of our internal security depends upon the cooperation shared by all the political parties, by the innumerable parties in our country. As we saw in the various nuclear deals and all, the opposition brought about by the parties was extremely important in the passing of it. My question revolves upon the involvement of the United States of America. On one hand, we see their involvement bringing about support and help to our country in terms of the nuclear deal and the F-16s we get from them. On the other hand, we also see their involvement in Pakistan, giving them the F-18s as well as the $1 billion aid for their various projects. Now, as much as we'd like to have the help from the United States of America, don't you think the involvement of a third party like this might just aggravate the situation as much as it might help India? Or rather, don't you think it's time for India to be more self-dependent on a situation like this, which might involve a situation as sensitive as the tensions between India and Pakistan?
I agree with you. I think by and large, we have followed our own policy. We've not really asked United States to come and be a mediator, which Pakistan has always wanted the US to mediate. The US is a superpower, and to that extent, they have an influence. But I think we take care of our own. I think our democracy is quite strong enough for us to be able to withstand pressures from any other country.
I think there was another Cotonian who had a question here. Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Abhinav. I'm from the 12th standard. My question was that you just pointed out that we have 3 lakh officer posts in the police services which lie empty. How do we expect to fill up these vacancies if the salaries of the policemen are so low that they can't take care of themselves in those small salaries?
Yeah, I think I agree with you that the constables are not so well paid. They don't have adequate housing. These are issues which I think are important, and I fully agree with you. You have to pay them well if you want them to be able to look after your security. But it's a matter which we are in the process of improving the housing conditions and so on. But I think the pay commission recommendations of the 6th pay commission have been slightly better, but they can definitely do with much more.
Mr. Gopal Krishna Pillai, my name is Srinivas, Gina Srinivas, and I don't know whether there are others in the same batch as you, but I had the privilege of being in the same batch in Cotton's in 1964 with you. So it's a deep pleasure and honor to be here with you. I happened to be visiting my parents from the United States, fell sick and extended my trip, and may gave me this wonderful opportunity to listen to you. It's a deep, deep honor and privilege. I also had the privilege of being with you during my IIT days, as you well recall. And I recall, though, in those days, your interest in going into IAS, and some of us with scientific interests, as you did, wondered about your goals and aspirations and the idealism that you showed even in those days. And I am deeply honored to see the great achievement you have obviously achieved. My purpose isn't to just talk about that, but in the course of your presentation, which was obviously wonderful, you also mentioned in particular
the pride and honor of the people of Manipur, and that again exemplified for me the deep passion you have for people, their rights, and their willingness. And it seems to me it is this type of attitude being more pervasive across the Indian government that is going to bring about the reduction in the threat of internal threat that you alluded to. And I hope you could comment a little bit whether I'm assuming there are equally dedicated and people with the same kind of passion that you have. But I would be interested in your opinion about how pervasive that is, because to me, that exemplifies the success that India can be. Thank you very much.
Anyway, great to see you, Gina. I think we have too little. I think we had that some time of Indian Frontier Administrative Service, which I thought had far more dedicated people than we have now. And I think that is it's something which is a worrying factor for all of us in government, that we don't have enough people with the empathy and the sensitiveness towards the problems of the Northeast. It's very complicated. We still say Northeast. We still talk of seven states, but it's almost like 30 different geographical groupings and different ethnic identities, each one very strong and very cohesive. There's a lot to be learned from many of the tribal societies and the way they handle problems. You know, in India, what we did was we imposed a Westminster model of government on everybody. In the rest of India, some of these areas, we were able to slowly get this assimilated. But in many of the tribal areas, this has become some sort of, it's something supra to their own tribal loyalties and tribal customs. And therefore, there is this hiatus between the two groups. And that reconciliation is yet to take place. It is a problem.
Jai Shankar, 1962. Rajdeep Sardesai writes in yesterday's papers about the current Home Minister. He says, the real strong man of India. Would you like to comment on it?
I think discretion is the better part of valor.
And that is an art. That is a lesson in the art of diplomacy, if there was ever one. I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen, we're really running short of time. Mr. Pillai will be on hand. Well, okay, on popular demand, we're going to take one question from a PC here and then come to Mr. Unnikrishnan. We'll have to leave it with that. I'm extremely sorry.
I'm Tarun of class 10. Is there something we as the common Indian people can do against the terrorists other than lighting candles?
Yeah, you almost got me stumped on what I had to say. I think basically, as a citizen, I think every time you follow, in one sense, the rules, you help get the system into order. It's whether whether it's rash driving, whether you throw trash on the road, whether it's, every small thing in one sense helps us get governance back online. I think that's where the small things are the most important things in governance. And you find a lot of time and effort being wasted in a lot of things. And if you're able to get the rule of law, as they said, rule of law not for me, but for everybody else. Everybody says, the rule of law is for him, I'm driving, I use a mobile, you say, that's okay, some emergency has come up. But you decide that, no, I will not. And that, in one sense, as a habit, if it's formed right across students and the next generation, because you're going to be, before you realize it, I can tell you, time flies so quickly. I look back and I say, I'm 1965, and I'm sure all of you must be looking at this guy and saying, 64, he looks like a grandfather, which I am anyway. But it's that fast time moves. So before you know it, you're going to be in my position and you'll have to decide what did you do.
And if I can supplement, with Mr. Pillai's permission, what you can do is you can join the army. You want an example, you've got one in General Thimaya. You want another example, you had one in Colonel Lalit Rai. And if you want another example, may I mention to you Major Sandeep Unnikrishnan, Ashok Chakra. We're delighted to have with us his parents, Mr. and Mrs. Unnikrishnan. Sandeep. Sandeep was a youngster like any of you, and he took the lead and he made the ultimate sacrifice for the country. Words fail me at a time like this, and I can only request Mr. Unnikrishnan to pose his question to Mr. Pillai.
Thank you, Mr. Sonthi. First of all, thanks for inviting me for such a learned audience. I'm very proud that I'm among one of the best of Bangalore's learned audience. Thank you. I was so much impressed by the statistical talk which our Home Minister has given, so Home Secretary has given. I'm authorized to say that. Rather than sanctioning additional contingents of paramilitary forces, of ITBP, BSF, CRPF, or whatever it is we have seen, have we any mechanism in place to check the effectiveness of the existing forces? I strongly believe that it is not there. If you think the National Security Guards, the NSG, from where my son has gone and fought, do you think that it is complete in every sense? It is not. It is not an elite force. In my opinion, a large number of officers and staff appointed to that or deputed to that is going there only for 25% of deputation allowance. They go for the commando training, 60% of them succeed, 40% of them go back. Nobody checks what is. See, the physical fitness is not only the criterion for an NSG posting. That itself is wrong. That is one part. The effectiveness of check on the preparedness of our existing forces before starting one thing. That is my first suggestion. The second suggestion will be, we are talking about the lethargy from political leaders. And I will quote one thing. One of our sitting MPs asked me a question which embarrassed the entire audience in Bangalore. Luckily, it was a very small function. Not many people listened to that. I was dumbstruck on that. He asked me, when did this 26/11 happen? He is a Telugu Desam MP, a sitting MP. Okay, that you leave alone. That is from a political leader or... But the lethargy from NSG, your own home ministry, you will be ashamed to listen to me that in the NSG memorial, the hero of 26/11, Major Sandeep Unnikrishnan's name is put as Sri Major U. Unnikrishnan. They could not spell that. It is still there, I think. I don't know what is the present condition. It's not Sandeep alone. I'm talking on behalf of all the 11 injured people. NSG has not done anything literally for them. There are people, those who are living with bullets in their chest, they are
hesitant to go to a government hospital or an RR hospital for a final removal of that, because it is almost half an inch from his heart. This is, I'm talking about the person for whom Sandeep has gone forward and died. So it is my duty, I think it is. And moreover, money flowed to us in crores. We are crore padis now, I agree. But still the government is giving Sandeep's dependent pension to his mother based on fifth pay commission. Sixth pay commission has come. This is an order based on 15 years old thing. There are so many things to tell. That's what I see. My wife prompted me to ask questions. I can talk about the lethargy of Home Ministry, NSG, the Home Minister himself. I'm talking to you because it is a contained audience. I hope press is not involved in this. I would like your comments on all these things. If you ask me, I can quote 101 suggestions and questions which NSC is lacking. The tailpiece is that recently the NSC celebrated its 25th Racing Day celebrations. An invitation came to us, I can even show you that. A single invitation to my wife, I was not invited. I was not invited for the 25th Racing Day celebrations of the National Security Guard, of which my son was a part, and the entire nation is to be ashamed on that. Your comments on that, please, sir.
First of all, I must slightly disagree with you in, I think the NSG is an elite force. The army sends some of its best selected persons. The army does that from the paramilitary forces also, we send the best forces. And I think your late son, I would be very proud to say that he's also one of the best persons who went into the NSG and gave the supreme sacrifice. You mentioned some of these issues. Unfortunately, I think if it has happened that he's not got the sixth pay commission pensions, or the invitation did not include you, I think it's a grave dereliction of duty, and you can rest assured that when I go back to Delhi, this is one of the first things which I will be doing, and I will take it up definitely. Yeah, that also I will check up. I didn't know, in fact. No, I didn't know about it. You have to. Okay. I've noted that. I think it's unacceptable as far as I'm concerned. It cannot happen that a wrong name is put.
See the letters on that, it is in a serial number. 53rd or 54th is Sandeep name. That is one thing. And see, it was full of dust, and somebody poured a bucket full of water to clear the dust. All in the brown, of the heroes of JNK, all the rest. I collected 25, 26. The letters and they gave to them. Nobody was there, no upkeep, it is an open monument. It is an open monument, it is in shambles.
I agree with you, I understand your anguish.
Demolish that, sir, it's just put a stone there and then don't put names.
I understand your anguish, let me go back. I will write to you after I have all those three, four items which you have mentioned to me. I will take it up and you can rest assured that you will get a letter from me on the action that you have indicated. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Pillai. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. My profuse apologies if we've not been able to accommodate all of you. I'm sure Mr. Pillai will be available on hand for a chat later. Ladies and gentlemen, may I, as is tradition, request Mrs. Mirai Changappa to please honor and acknowledge Mr. Pillai's stellar performance today by presenting him with a memento on behalf of the trust. Mrs. Changappa. Thank you, Mrs. Mutana. We're missing General Avdesh Prakash this morning. May I request on behalf of the Kumaon Regiment, one of the senior most Kumaoni officers in Bangalore, and I hope the general is still with us. May I request General Arjun Ray to please come forward? I think General has left. Would Major General Sarvate be with us now? Colonel Pokela? Colonel Uthaya, may I kindly request you to come forward, sir? And to do the honors, I hope I'm not imposing myself, sir. We understand fully your pain and your anguish. We're hopeful that with Mr. Pillay's interference, all or at least some of your anxieties will be put to rest. May I request Mr. Unnikrishnan to kindly come forward and present the memento to Colonel Uthaya on behalf of the Kumaon Regiment. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Colonel Uthaya. Thank you, Mr. Unnikrishnan. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a first in the sense we've been able to convince Admiral Shekhawat to join us from Jaipur, all the way from Jaipur. Deeply honored to have you with us, sir. As the patron of the General K.S. Thimaiah Memorial Trust, this slide will tell you a former chief of the Naval Staff, an old Cotonian, a Veer Chakra awardee from the 1971 operations. And if only any of you boys take a look at his crest, you'll be amazed at the number of blues he's been awarded. That is really a record that I would challenge any of you to break. Thank you very much, Admiral Shekhawat, for being here. And to do the honors, could I request an old boy and a colleague from the 1971 operations, Commodore Franklin, to kindly come forward. Thank you, Commodore. We're missing today another of our patrons, Air Marshal Malcolm Wallen. Air Marshal Mally Wallen is the former Deputy Chief of the Air Staff and the Air Officer Commanding of the very crucial Eastern and Western Air Commands. He commanded the MiG Squadron, which you know is the sort of flagship squadron for the Air Force. A 1944 batch Cotonian and somebody who stood by us all along. We're really missing him today because he's indisposed and in Goa. But we have, if I may say, an adequate substitute in his nephew, Philip Wallen. And may I request Phil to kindly receive a memento on behalf of Air Marshal Wallen. To do the honors, I hope that Phil's classmate from school, Shabir Sharif, is with us. And if you could kindly come forward. Thank you, Shabir. Ladies and gentlemen, the third of our patrons, Lieutenant General S.K. Jaitley, PVSM, AVSM, SM, a Sword of Honor winner, the former Colonel Commandant of the Central India Horse, the Commandant of the NDA, and the former Deputy Chief of the Air Staff, a 1956 batch Cotonian. We're deeply honored to have you with us, sir. And may I request Brigadier Franklin, old Cotonian 1962 batch, to kindly come forward and do the honors. Brigadier Franklin, incidentally, was the Commandant of the Corps of Military Police and has continued the rich tradition of Cotonians in the armed forces. Thank you, Brigadier. Ladies and gentlemen, I must place on record the fact that we also have with us two former chiefs of the staff, apart from Admiral V.S. Shekhawat. We have with us perhaps one of the senior most officers in Bangalore and personally somebody who's supported these ventures. We're delighted to announce that Admiral O.S. Dawson is with us today. And to felicitate Admiral Dawson, may I kindly request Rear Admiral Sampath Pillai to come forward, please. Thank you, Admiral Pillai. We also have with us the previous Chief of the Air Staff, Air Chief Marshal Fali Major. I must place on record, sir, our gratitude for joining us at short notice. We are deeply honored. We had the pleasure of listening to Air Chief Marshal Major at the Air Chief Marshal Khatre Memorial Lecture. And if any of us missed it, I think it was at our own peril. Greatly honored to have you with us, sir. To do the honors, may I kindly request Air Marshal Dotiwala to come forward, please. Thank you, Air Marshal Dotiwala. I must mention that Air Marshal Dotiwala is an old Josephite. And we are very, very grateful to the Air Marshal for joining us. It's the spirit of friendship to take all of these things for granted. But the fact remains that we have had an extraordinary deal of cooperation from Colonel Ellis. And to felicitate Colonel Ellis, may I kindly request Mr. Michael Watsa. I don't know if he's still here. Chairman of the OCA, to kindly come forward. Thank you, Mike. I know you have a flight to catch. Bon voyage. And it's all pleasure. He's off to Goa. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for bearing with us. I think a few thank yous are in order. Firstly, of course, to Mr. Pillai for that scintillating address. We can't thank you enough, sir. We had our hearts in our mouth when the Rajdhani was hijacked last week. We honestly believe that it would be rather difficult for him to come down. I don't know if we're able to express our gratitude to have a serving Union Home Secretary to take the time and the trouble to come all the way down to Bangalore. Deeply obliged to you, sir. Thank you for being here. I place on record our gratitude for General Avdesh, his staff officer, Colonel Rajiv Ghai, and the entire team at the Military Secretary's office all the way in South Block who've worked with us. Not only in South Block, they've had friends come down from Ranikhet, which is the Kumaoni headquarters, to support us, and we're very gratified. Colonel Ellis, thank you once again. We hope to come back and trouble you every year. General Mrs. Chengappa and the family members of General Timaya, thank you very much. It's great power to our elbow to have your support. Mrs. Franklin, who's probably left for a contingency, but it's wonderful that we're getting the girls to attend as well. Thank you, Mr. Acharya, for that very, very heartwarming introduction to Mr. Pillai. A special thank you to all serving and retired officers of the armed forces. We greatly appreciate your presence. Thank you to our non-Cotonian guests. I've said this before last year, and I say it again at the cost of repetition. When we say it's a General Timaya lecture of a few old boys of Cotton's, the natural question is it a Cotonian event? Well, I don't think I need to convince you that General Timaya was more than a Cotonian. This event is for all. And I appreciate deeply the spirit that non-Cotonians have shown in perceiving what we're trying to do. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, Cotonians. You're the bedrock of these lecture series. We can't do it without you. Keep coming back, talk about it, support us, give us ideas, help us improve, but continue to support us. Thank you very much, Cotonians. Thank you to all of those who've written in. If we've had a few hundred attend today, I must tell you that we've had several hundred write in. The support has been overwhelming. I place on record our gratitude for the three chiefs of staff who've written in congratulating and encouraging us. A big thank you to them. Thank you all volunteers. You know who you are. We couldn't have done this without you. And finally, thank you to my co-trustees, C.N. Kumar, Kiran Lakhani, Jairaj Daniel, Rajiv Purnaya. It's been brilliant working with you guys, and I hope we keep doing this. Ladies and gentlemen, we started this lecture series as a very loosely formed, internally funded venture. We were very anxious as to how it would pan out. The support and the encouragement has been tremendous. And in order to consolidate what we're doing, we've actually taken the ambitious step of establishing the General K.S. Timaiya Memorial Trust with the support and blessings of the General's family. And we intend to create an endowment so that we can continue to bring you more such treats. I'm delighted to tell you that the support has been overwhelming, and God willing, with such support, we will continue to bring you more such lectures. Thank you very much. We'll see you again in the 2010 lecture. Thank you, Jai Hind.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stay for the national anthem, before which we have a comment here. Please bear with us for a minute.
Who are present here, it is my humble request to please give a standing ovation to Mr. Pillai.